Dr. Day.
Thank you. Thank you for a very warm welcome. I'll take 1 minute to just make some announcements with the permission of the chair. First thing is, welcome everyone. You're all here in big strength in the first session and continue to participate. Second thing is, there is an app which is available. The link has been sent. For some reason, maybe everyone's email is not there, so perhaps it hasn't gone through, but we will be putting up a little standee where the link will be shown, and you can download it from the, you know, from Google or App Store. The third thing is, there will be no mementos which will be given to either the chair or the speakers on the podium in interest of time, but you can collect it from the registration desk. And the other thing is, the next speaker, Dr. Tadej Betlano, is actually going to speak in the afternoon. So straight after this, we will go into some questions, and then the panel, and then we'll break for tea. So with that, let me start my talk. I like to start with this slide whenever I speak about diabetes, because in the past we had light that flickered. We had insulin, initially animal insulin, later on recombinant insulin, and then we had HbA1c. And now we have a light that flames. We have the CGMS and the CSII. That passionate talk by Dr. Swaminathan woke us up to the fact that this could be done in our country for extremely socioeconomically challenged children. We have to put our, you know, hands together and support the underprivileged. And it's not very far away when there will be the insulin, the artificial pancreas, and that is very much in the pipeline. I believe is going to be rolled out sometime next year in the United States. So we all participate in the World Diabetes Day, and it's on the 14th of November, which is the birthday of Frederick Banting. And that's really when the modern era of diabetes management started in 1921. And we've had HbA1c from the 60s. We have the blood glucose meters from 77, insulin pump therapy in the late 70s, which has now become refined over the years. And we have glucose sensor, and now CGMS. So these are the three glucose technologies, and they help us together give us a lot of core information about how the glycemic exposure and variability during the monitoring of the patient. And as you all know, the A1C is the gold standard. In fact, 1993, there was this very, very epochal event when the DCCT study was basically published, wherein they showed that HbA1c, lowering it, had enormous benefit in preventing micro and macro angiopathic complications. UKpedia studies on type 2 diabetes showed similar results. But now, recently we are examining this concept. Is HbA1c still the gold standard? So, as you see, all HbA1c's are not created equal. In fact, it's a joke, if I stand with 1 foot in a bucket of ice water, 1 foot in a bucket of boiling water, on average, I'm comfortable. The CGM reveals insights beyond finger stick testing, and there was a very eloquent lecture by my previous speaker who really went into the minutiae of the use of CGM, so I'll not be repetitive. So the bottom line is, A1C does not track glycemic excursions, and 60% of glucose lows may not be revealed with SMBG alone. So what is CGM? In brief, one slide, it's the movie. It is the entire movie. No snapshots, and you can keep seeing, you know, minute by minute, real time, and you can get a lot of data which you can action on. CGMS has been around and been encouraged and basically has been endorsed by various, you know, statutory bodies. And however, if we now move to the next level, which is if this announcement came in the ADA 2018 document, which said, with increasing use of CGMS devices, outcomes other than A1C, such as time with glucose in target range and frequency of hypoglycemia, should be considered in the overall assessment of glycemic control. And this is the Medtronic sensor, this is the Libre Pro sensor, and this is the reading with a Libre Pro, an AGP, and this is what the trace shows, which my previous speaker so eloquently analyzed. Now this is a pivotal slide because it compares A1C with CGM, and so let's go. CGM compares glucose levels 3 months apart, whereas CGM compares fluctuations for any given amount of time. A1 does not capture hypoglycemic or hyperglycemic levels, less likely to capture impact of acute intervention, not the most important parameter for diabetic patient, does not improve patient's mood and quality of life, reduces the risk, but it reduces the risk of macrovascular disease. Now, you saw this slide before, but I will want to bring you to this particular part of that slide. You see, there are two things here, time in range and time out of range. And this is the real pivotal concept now. So, hyperglycemia, now what is the PPG postprandial glucose recommendation? The ADA and EASD, it should be less than 180. And hypoglycemia is defined by sugar less than 70. So the new metric is time in range is 70 to 180 and should achieve that 80% of the time. If you are below 70, you are level 1 hypo, below 54, you are level 2, and level 3 if you are severely hypoglycemic. Similarly, above 180 is level 1 hyper, above 250, level 2, and DKA, diabetic ketoacidosis. So it's very interesting that in the DCCD study, they did 7-point glucose profile for 1 week every 3 months on every patient, and used that data to kind of calculate a time in range, and they found the ones who had retinopathy or microalbuminuria were the ones whose time in range were poor. And it is interesting that this data was from late 80s and early 90s, and people went back and looked at the data. Now, why are we getting so, at this point in time, so concerned about this keeping it in range? When I trained many years ago in Cincinnati Children, we were very, very conscious about hypoglycemia. We wanted to avoid that. Back of our mind, we felt a little hyperglycemia is, in a small child, is acceptable. But now the paradigm has really been shifting because they have found the association of hyperglycemia with lower cognitive scores and altered brain growth. In this study, they basically showed that children and adolescents with type 1 diabetes, exposure to glycemic extremes overlaps with the time period of most active brain and cognitive development, leading to concerns that these children are at risk for cognitive side effects. And this was a meta-analysis which also concluded that in patients with type 1 diabetes, cognitive dysfunction is characterized by slowing of mental speed and a diminished mental flexibility, although learning and memory were spared. So both extremes are to be avoided. So going back to this signature slide, I think this is really the new mantra. Keep the sugars between 70 and 180. And important thing, use advanced technology. And I think the conclusion of the previous speaker is CGMS is available, use it. CSII is available, and the speaker before that, Dr. Swaminathan, said we can join together and acquire. And that truly is now going to be the gold standard. So this is very interesting, this Pentagon comprehensive glucose Pentagon model. And basically here, this is the area of safety. And the more you go away, it's called time out of range. The more you spend time in these areas, you are going to be endangering the future of that child. So this is clinical target for continuous glucose monitoring data recommendation. This is a very current article, and I will encourage especially the students to look through this, because this encapsulated all that I have said so far. And this study shows very, very clearly that each incremental 5% increase in time in range is associated with clinically significant benefits for type 1 and type 2 diabetes. In the range 70 to 180, try and keep it 70%. And I recently heard Professor Tadej Batlano, who's among us, he'll speak in the afternoon, and if you can come right now, he'll be in the panel as well. But he mentioned that it's dynamic. So the first 12 hours, you're falling behind, your time in range is actually not much, 30-40%. The second 12 hours, you can catch up and get back into time in range and have overall 70 to 80% over 24 hours. So today we were challenged because we had some delay in the delivery of the hall. So we basically have been trying to save time. So I have deliberately kept my talk short, and I will finish before time, giving more time for questions. So basically, the take-home message is time in range is the new paradigm in T1DM management. If you keep the sugars in that range, your A1C will be below 7. Your hyperglycemic and hypoglycemic insult, especially to the brain, will be diminished, and you will prevent microangiopathic complications in future. So that is the way to go. And with technology with us, especially different forms of, you know, CGMS, we can achieve it. So avoid hypo and hyperglycemia. CGMS is mandatory. Well, it's a gold standard in all countries where they can afford it. In CSII is also the way to go forward. A1C goal is not redundant yet. Goal is below 7. And diabetes technology to increase time in range will prevail. So thank you very much for your kind attention. These are these beautiful children and my, you know, medical staff. We took this picture at the World Diabetes Day. They all need our help. There's only one pumper among them. And as you can see, the youngest child there is a toddler, 18 months old, came in severe decay and went home walking. So thank you again.